Welcome to the Nehemiah Entrepreneurship Community Podcast. I'm your host, Patrice Sagi. I'm here today with Susan Schrem, good friend, one of our board members, an entrepreneur. You don't use the word retired, do you? That's right. What do you say? Well, an ex-executive. How does that sound? An ex-executive.
My own firm.
There it is. And so you know, I've come to know Susan for really less than a year, maybe a year, and she's a delight. I mean, she's got spunk. You know, I am telling you, she just got spunk, and you're gonna discover this. So today's podcast, we're titling this one today, "De-risking the New Normal." De-risk is a term that I came to know through Susan Schrem because of what she does. And she really has been working with us and helping us de-risk our own strategy. We're going to talk more about that as we look to create 100,000 jobs around the globe. She's an excellent communicator. I've met very few people that have the ability to capture ideas and both in writing and orally, be able to rearticulate it in a way that commands a group and an audience, get people's attention. And Susan does that. And so just a great partner and a great friend. Susan, welcome again to the podcast.
Thank you. You're setting the bar high. So I got to be on my game here.
Well, I know you do well. Well, Susan, I want our audience to kind of know what we're dealing with here. We are in the midst of the COVID-19, but I really want to kind of begin to lay the groundwork for your journey. So you crack your teeth in corporate America.
Yeah, I spent many decades working with Fortune 500 companies, IBM, Siemens, Nokia, and then smaller ones that are only $1 billion companies. But in all cases, my role was to take a big idea and get it out the door and successfully adopt it. So that could have been the acquisition of a company, it could be the launch of a product, it could be the launch of a new program, a new pricing strategy. And my role always was that idea of translating, you know, concepts to execution. And in that process, as we just said, de-risking it so that people would actually take an action.
Mm-hmm. And so when you do risking, so many people, this is the first time they've heard that term. I know I heard the term the first time with you. What does that exactly mean to de-risk?
So I'd say, here's the deal. Does everybody know what risk is? It's the possibilities things won't work out as planned, right? Interestingly enough, the opposite of risk is not necessarily fail. You know, risking does not mean failure. You can risk something and you take conscious risk because you know there's uncertainty, but risking consciously means that you follow some processes to eliminate the common mistakes that are made as you bring new initiatives or a pivot strategy. So in some cases, I think de-risking is, maybe I made up the phrase, but de-risking is reducing the risk by simply eliminating the common mistakes people make and consciously make decisions that will optimize the speed to adoption of your idea.
Mm, wow, I love it. And so from your experience, if a company does not de-risk, what happened?
Well, a few things. And it depends on where they are in their life cycle, right? So at the very beginning with a startup, the greatest risk of a startup is it never gets off the ground. And a lot of resources and energy are invested that come to the fruition. Later, as an organization evolves, there's risk of stalling. So you end up with an organization, a mission, it works well, but it just slows, growth slows, or energy flows, or you know, in some cases you'll end up with a scenario where you had an anticipation of milestones and they just aren't getting achieved as fast as possible. Mm. Another risk is one of relevance, losing relevance. Mm. And so in that sense, the world changed around you. So it's not that you stalled, you're going crazy, but the world changed around you and suddenly your plans to achieve something have more risk than thought. So I'd say that sort of speaks to today, where some people are dealing with a world that just changed around us with a lot of dimensions.
Mm, I love it. So let's talk about, before we get to today, you know, you've had a pretty incredible career. As you think back, let's talk a bit about moments of crisis that you've had to navigate through your career or just in life in general? And give us a bit about what lessons have you learned in those experiences that kind of you can bring back to today?
Okay, so let me tell you about a crisis when you're in middle school. Mm. This player, that's not what you expected. I was with a corporate nomad dad who moved us around everywhere when I was a kid. And so I moved in elementary school, middle school, high school, and college. You know, we were always moving around. And one of the things that creates when you when your world changes is that you create the sense of uncertainty, will I be successful? And one of the ways that I was taught to be more resilient was to step back from that moment and say, what is it about what I'm doing that I like? And what about the new place? Could I actually change something about how I approach myself or my friends or whatever and be more successful in this new place? Mm-hmm. Little did I know, as they were trying to help me as a kid, how many times that same kind of framework helps when, you know, companies buy out your company, they sell off your company. I've had been in many, many, many mergers and acquisitions where either my company was the acquirer or the one getting sold. Mm-hmm. But in any of those cases, you have to reframe. Okay, so this disruption has happened. How can I optimize in this situation? And that, you know, the crisis that, you know, I had professional crisis that whether those are, you know, your job gets eliminated or a scenario where the assumptions you made, I had a global product marketing responsibility and the assumption in terms of resources was one thing. And then very quickly it went from this to this. And so suddenly it was a crisis of viability. Like we had assumed we were going to do it with this level of resources. And now you suddenly have to do it with vastly less. So, you know, it's a, I think in most cases, what I've learned is what I'm now teaching others, is to step back and create some frameworks and then consciously eliminate those things that we know to be stumbling blocks and consciously take steps to make steps that have a framework so that the scope of it is not gonna, you know, destroy you if you take a try something, but it's something they can learn from. So sort of iterative, agile learning as you try to move forward in an uncertain and less clear path.
Wow. So with that, let's talk about COVID-19.
Okay, perfect.
Now, Susan, there's a new normal, as you know. There's a new normal. And how different is COVID-19 when you compare it to historical business crisis, economic crisis, and those kind of things, from your perspective?
You know, it's funny, I was just discussing this today, where if you think about the buckets of change, we have a disease is one type of issue, mm-hmm. a new way of working within that caution, which is the virtual model, and the third is an economic downturn, mm-hmm. okay? Now, we've often had economic downturns. They weren't always entirely global, but they often tend to be seasonal. But you know, whether it was the 2000s, early 2000s, or even you know the 1918, you know, you had economic downturns that caused challenge. Then you've got disease and the health issues, which are very serious, but are focused. They are a group of people with expertise in solving a disease. Then you've got this middle space, which is a new uncertainty about how fast we'll be able to come back to work. How will working models work when you still have the uncertainty of virus? So you're managing on all three at once. Some people see this as a huge opportunity because they have the tools, the products, the services that actually meet whether the medical needs to, or research needs or whatever, or they meet the needs of a virtual working model. Or they're creating new jobs that didn't exist before in that virtual model. So I think what's different is that it's a global discussion. So mm-hmm. that in the past, I think some of this was isolated. Now it's a whole community worldwide, which is a real gift. And the fact is that we actually have a conscious discussion of changing the way we work across the board. And that means to me that it is an invitation for people to experiment and try new things openly. Whereas in the past, I think you might have thought that you by yourself were dealing with a downsizing or dealing with a market issue. If everybody's dealing with a market issue and everybody's going to try something new, there's actually been an opportunity for innovation that's never happened before. So wow. Not that I always am a Pollyanna, but it's an unusual moment where the very things that people are worrying about are actually creating new opportunities for creativity and innovation.
Wow. So with that, let's now get into what that really looks like. So from you've been helping a lot of nonprofits, including us, navigate this whole idea of de-risking, going to virtual platforms, whatever the case may be. So what are some opportunities that this presents?
Well, what I'd like to do is think about your business model, because I think one of the things that happens when change happens is that people, they see pieces. Like they see, oh my gosh, people have to stay at home, so you have to use tools like the ones we're using here. But if you step back and say, what just happened and does it challenge my, is there a change to the problem I'm solving as a business? Or as a nonprofit, is the problem still there? And when you clarify whether the problem you solve is still there, that keeps your rudder, that allows you to say, okay, yes or no. If it no longer is there, then it's a real need to pivot, right? Mm-hmm. Because really you're spending a lot of energy where there's no need. But if there's an opportunity to, yes, the problem's still there, but the way we're going to solve it is different. Yes, mm-hmm. The mission is still there, but the way we're going to solve it is different. Then instead of just randomly brainstorming ideas of ways to do things, systematically look at your business model as a way to say, okay, who are my customers that I serve? Could there be new ones? Could they be global instead of domestic, for instance, in this model? Does the channels to market change? Do I have both online and physical mix of channels to market? Do I have partners that I never considered before, or infrastructure that I need to build that I never considered before? And I think one thing I find about the business model construct, I use the business model canvas, which is a nice little visual tool that allows you to see it all on one page. But one thing I think that helps is it helps the whole cross-functional team see the entire business as a whole. Most of the time, when we're running and gunning, a lot of organizations, small and large, are siloed. Like, so the functions work in pieces. And there's good reasons for that. They're experts in what they do. But especially when you're trying to make a change, to help everybody step back and see the business as a whole, or the organization, nonprofit is a business as a whole, then how do you both create opportunities for new customers, new ways to reach them, new tools, new ways to keep those relationships, as well as the back end? How does my infrastructure, my partners, my costs, my resources change? So what does that mean? So in a virtual world, it could mean that you could complement face-to-face events like trade shows and conferences with virtual events. It can mean services that people used to only deliver physically. They could deliver them. They could actually deliver a service using an online vehicle instead of delivering it virtually, instead of delivering it face to face. I'd say if you're in the shipping and distribution industry, you're doing great, because suddenly everybody else who's going virtual needs somebody to do the physical part, right? So suddenly huge amount of new ways to think about delivery models and local serving of people in new ways. So I don't know, your business actually, which is a global business already, and you've already built a virtual approach. How is your business? Everybody's catching up with you actually, right? Yeah. I mean, the world virtual now because you were already virtual.
It's been a gift for us. What I told our team is that COVID is like buying, it's like the Lord bought us a free global advertising, right? A free global ad that with our face on it to say, to push everybody to the, or imagine if we owned the mall and all of a sudden the government just close all the roads and you have to go by our mall. That's how we feel.
Yeah.
is that traffic has just been redirected to where we are. So we're seeing, get an example, context. So we had a learning forum this morning. We had 70 registrations. Our learning forum, typically the highest we've had was 20 registrations. We had a Asia Biblical Business Solution last week. We had 140 registration. And by the way, a 91% show up rate. Today was about a 60 plus percent show up rate. So we're seeing a boost in obviously in engagement. But what we're also seeing, Susan, is that now what we had to do as an organization is now still think different, because now not only has traffic has been wrecked where we are, but guess what every other business is doing? They're moving to where we are, right? So from that vantage point, we had to say, okay, we're no longer the only kid on the block. So we have to be a little more competitive. We have to be rethink. And then by the way, because everybody's consuming digitally, how do we make our digital consumption more engaging, more dynamic? And you even helped us as we thought about our conference coming up. And how do we rethink that? You know, we have some session with you where you kind of gave us some thoughts about how do you, I like the point you made, and I want you to elaborate on that. You talked about the idea of helping people experience digitally the feel, the touch, and the smell. Could you elaborate on that? Because, you know, we train our trainers to think multi, to train people using the all learning styles, right? Mm-hmm. To think about the very learning styles. But when you gave me that visual, what did it for me is recognize this, is that, you know, is that I need to think multidimensional, right, as I deploy digitally. Could you elaborate on that, why that was, that's an important point?
The thing that's going to happen is if everybody catches up and is delivering whatever the offering is virtually, then it's going to do two things. It's going to require differentiation of your offering, and you better know why yours is better, right? But right, how are you going to differentiate? It doesn't have to only be from the words we speak. It can be from the end-to-end experience people have. And so like anything, people, I did say, consider all the senses. How could you possibly deliver smell and taste when you're talking on a virtual platform? Well, right now, if you planned to have an effective lunch break where you designed and ahead of time told everybody that everybody's going to make a meal, the same meal. And then as they connect with you, they're actually connecting with the food as well. Or you could actually ship to them tastes and smells and things that are part of your experience. Well, just like you would if you're face-to-face, you'd have them go through a lunch line. You'd have them have a cocktail party. These are ways. And the other thing is feel. I mean, there's a lot of people who are very physical. They need notebooks to write things down. They need structure. They appreciate when you give that handout that allows them to take notes in one section, right? So those kind of tool sets that were a normal part of physical environments need to be thought through in new ways. And my recommendation is, candidly, to walk the entire process of a customer experience from the moment they hear that you're going to have the experience to the time they've gone and left, and plan that the benefit of the digital is that these people can have an ongoing relationship. You don't have that random person who walks in, you didn't get their name. You have more knowledge of these people. But I think the mistake to be made is to just think of it as the very narrow event, thinking it from the beginning to end and planning for one, their experience, and two, the content that you're making. Right now we're creating content that can be then delivered anytime someone else dials in, right? And that creates a very much bigger model for more people to attend. However, they, in their time frame, when they download, they'd like to have the same tool. So how do you make yourself available to them in their replay? So I think what will be fun for your organization and others is to start brainstorming, what's the most exceptional experience you ever had? And then amp your game in terms of how to deliver that virtually, and recognize that you're building a relationship and you're building a community as you do it. And that puts more responsibility on you as the convener.
Yeah. It makes sense. As a matter of fact, so Susan, Nehemiah Week registration is open, guys. And Susan will be with us this year. Matter of fact, she will be emceeing with me. We're going to be emceeing this thing together because I thought, who do I know that can really bring the sexy into digital emceeing? And
okay, there's another bar. You just keep raising the bar.
That is going to be. Now, but also, so May 5th, we've invited Susan to be on a panel with us. We're going to be doing a biblical business tools forum with four entrepreneurs. It's going to be totally geared towards the United States market around how do we succeed post-COVID-19? Because our president has announced that America is open up beginning the first week of May. And so there's going to be a sequential opening up. Business will get back to business. And so we want to help Mr. Trump with this process and begin to facilitate a dialogue around how to help entrepreneurs get back to work. So Susan, as you prepare, and by the way, if you want to know more about this conference, this forum, go to our website, nehemiahproject.org, and just learn how to register. Richard's not up yet. They'll be up in the next several days. You can register. Nehemiah registration is up there. So Susan, let's talk about America opening up. And we talk about de-risking, right? This is about de-risking. So how do I think about opening up, considering how to de-risk my getting back to work so that I don't, you know, I don't fall on my face come May?
So a second, in addition to the business model, which sort of frames who you are as a whole, the second tool that I really think needs to be tuned for most entrepreneurs, heck, for every business, is more effective scenario planning. Let's talk about what that means. So many people do scenario planning. Some people call it brainstorming, right? It's coming up with an idea of how it will be different. What people skip is they skip the quantifying of it. So you've got a few dimensions of a scenario. So let's say one scenario is you open up your doors and you have narrow hours, right? Or you open up your doors with only a few, and the rule is you can only have people 6 feet apart in your physical space. Okay, how is that going to work? If people just sort of plan it out conceptually, that's one thing. But if they started putting pen to paper and say, let's do some scenarios, let's do some ranges. Let's, how many clients could that mean we could serve? Let's do some ranges in terms of average sale. What if they end up coming in and just looking around and you know, they don't like the experience? What if we get too much demand? How are we going to figure out how to keep the demand, but serve them in a new way? So ranges is really important. And then the third is what to do, the what if planning, again, quantified. So then what ranges could be happening? What if the majority of the time people are, it ramps up. And then the last thing I'd say is to rank them. Sometimes people plan a lot for something that's very unlikely to happen, right? Mm-hmm. So if you could figure out a range scenario and you could figure out the, quantify it in terms of the dollar implications, and you have this available to you, if things don't work as planned, you've already thought through, oh, right. Okay, right. We know what to do as a group if the line gets too long. We know what to do. We've already got our little handout to how to reach us. We have already got a marketing plan that tells people the hours where certain things will be available. I think in most cases, people are doing a great job today. I mean, I think the resourcefulness of restaurants right now is incredible, right? They are showing us innovation and creativity. But a lot of times that comes from School of Hard Knocks, right? The gift you have as a, now the open up, is to have thought through the what ifs and then have a game plan and have your entire team be part of shaping it with you so that they feel some ownership for it. And then when these scenarios happen, it's like everybody goes to plan B or C. Mm-hmm. You know, nobody's going, oh my gosh, what are we gonna do? Hair on fire, right? It's, yeah, right. Remember that we talked about that. And it's a calming factor. The other thing I'd say is something I learned from Todd Thibodeau, who's a CEO of a very large association. He said, also apply the misery index, which is I will be miserable if we don't have the right people to do this. In other words, we cannot, there's only so much capacity we have to pull off this. So we may have tremendous ideas of all the things we could do, but with the capacity we have, the energy we have, the health we have, you know, let's make sure that we set expectations for our customers for what we can deliver well. And that's probably a better way to open up the doors than implying that the doors are open and whatever your past memory was is going to be exactly the same.
You know what? Ooh, that is, you know what? Hey guys, listen, come to the firm because she's going to unpack this more. Come to Nehemiah Week because she's going to unpack this even more there. But Susan, you bring up a point. Because part of scenario planning is this: what if there's an uptick in the virus, in the cases, and we are now invited to pull back? Mm-hmm. If I haven't run that scenario prior, right, I freeze.
You freeze, exactly. It's a fight, flight, and freeze scenario. Exactly.
You got it. And so you're really inviting us to say, if you're going to de-risk the opening up, you need to run what is scenarios on all the possibilities that could occur so that my team is ready to respond and react in whatever it is. I was coaching a client this morning.
Your team, you know, it's interesting because then your suppliers, then your partners. Right. So again, this goes back to your stakeholders. A lot of times people plan for themselves, but they haven't communicated to others.
Yeah.
So I think that that what they all say is closing down is easier than opening up, and setting expectations for people sequentially, and also be honest to the fact you're trying something. I mean, everybody's experimenting. So you can say, we're going to try it this way. And for the next 2 weeks, this is what we're doing. And we think we can handle it. I mean, you can be very open to your customers and to your employees. And I mean, I think the communication, by the way, is the third way to de-risk. The most common mistake I saw major CEOs make, big companies, little companies, is silence when you don't know. And that is death. Silence, everybody fills with their fear, their own perspective. Mm-hmm. If you don't have a regular cadence of communicating, here's what we know, here's what we don't know. Of what we don't know, here's how we're trying to find out, and here's what we'll give back to you today, next with what something we know. That cadence, that is so calming, and it allows everyone in your organization to communicate with you. They have more expertise than you do because they're experiencing it differently. So if you can combine that, so it's two-way communication through this. I remind, in running very large trade shows, we would every single night after a day, we'd get together afterwards and say, okay, who did you talk to? What did you learn? Tomorrow, don't hand out those little handouts. Nobody's using them, you know? And you know, we would make on the fly corrections whenever we were launching a product, you know, within the first 2 days, are the questions that we had everybody armed with, are they the right answers? And so I think the ability to have as part of your plan, a very, very tight two-way communication model, which is very honest and genuine and authentic, is going to be a critical solution, a part of de-risking as well.
I love it. You can see why I love this gal. I mean, you know, so again, if you put on your calendar, May 5th, Biblical Business Tools for Success Post-COVID-19 Forum, and also put on your calendar Nehemiah Week, the week of August, I believe 16th. Go to our website to get more information about it. Susan, our time is up, but I'm going to have you come back because we got to talk about job creation and the 100K initiative and how that plays out, because a lot of jobs have been lost, covered. So we kind of behind the eight ball. About how do we fast track and get the job piece? We'll deal with that when you get back. But before we resume, before we close, give a kind of a summary to our audience here. You share some key things about the points on de-risking our strategy, whether navigating COVID or opening up. You talked about understanding the business model and making sure that I love what you said. Ask the question, is my mission still relevant? Does the need still exist? Maybe only the how has changed. I like that precision because it helps me to think through every component of it. That was one thing you said. Could you walk through each of the things so we can kind of get it?
Three ideas, and you all can share what you're learning, but three ideas. The business model as a construct instead of just a piece. The second, and it's clarity of the mission and focus. The second is scenario planning quantified, so that your what if planning actually arms you for a lot of different things. Even if they don't all happen, at least you have a game plan for different scenarios. And then the third is communication, so that you're at all points in time, you're communicating and you're getting the feedback and you're making people feel very comfortable that they have an impact on how things can work as well.
I love it. So Susan, our friends are listening all over the world. And first of all, how can people get in touch with somebody saying, hey, I wanna be able to connect with you, Susan? How do I do that?
So my my email is susan.schramm, S-C-H-R-A-M as in Mary, M as in Mary, at my company name, gotomarketimpact.com. You can also see me on my website, where I also have a course that we're a program actually, where we take people through a de-risking process. And we're doing that in June to help people get ready for second half 2020. Many, many times they're trying to pivot. And we what we do there is systematically take your plan through it and eliminate things that commonly are mistakes. And you walk out with a prioritized approach to your second half.
I love it. I love it. Again, Susan will be with us May 5th for the Business Forum. Susan will also be with us at Nehemiah Week come August. Now, if you're listening wherever you are around the world, I hope you've been blessed. And my encouragement to you is that you use this, whatever your circumstance, whether in Malaysia, Nigeria, Cameroon, Paris, wherever you are, all of this stuff work. And our prayer is that you not only succeed, but you will thrive in this moment, in this season. We'll be back next week with Susan, as we deal now with how do you build on, how do you use all of this to create jobs? Because ultimately, if jobs aren't created, right, we cannot survive as an economy and we cannot thrive as a community. I'm not sure about your country, but in the United States, there's a lot of stimulus going on, but the only way to pay back that stimulus is that businesses are able to thrive and jobs are created because taxes need to go back to the treasury. With that said, let me leave you with this. By the way, if you want to be part of our community, for us to come alongside you, train you, and coach you to be a viable entrepreneur, a kingdom company, I'd like for you to go to our website, nehemiahproject.org, and join us and let us know how we can serve you so that we together can transform the world. Let me leave you with this. May the Lord bless you. And may you be so diligent in what He's called you to do so that one day, you can hear those wonderful words. Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. He'll not make you rule over much. God bless you. Susan, thank you so much.
Welcome. See you later.